Direct air capture is the gold standard for carbon removal. We, of course, need massive deep decarbonization. But for the hardest to decarbonize areas, we also need a huge amount of carbon removal. We need this carbon removal to be done in a way that is monitored, reported, and verifiable.
We know we need the nature-based solutions in scale and abundance, but we need all the solutions in scale and abundance. We just need, and I believe we're already in a post-moral hazard world, if we succeed at everything, if we succeed at efficiency and renewables and nuclear and electric vehicles and buildings and hydrogen, if we succeed at all of that, we will still need 10 gigatons. That's 20%. Like, it is a huge number. And it's not because we hate those other things, it's just the arithmetic drives us to that outcome.
We're going to have to pursue a range of removal technologies. We're going to have to pursue nature-based solutions like regenerative agriculture and reforestation. We're going to have to pursue engineered solutions like carbon capture and storage and like direct air capture. And of all of them, direct air capture offers some enormous benefits. It's scalable, it's verifiable, it's extremely high quality, and you can have a lot of flexibility on where you locate it. But I think that we have a responsibility, every one of us, in every firm that we're in, to be looking at how we accelerate on that journey and how we help others accelerate. If people don't step, I mean, the charts were very clear. If we don't get to gigatons worth of capacity in 2050, we have no shot to get the cost down to where we need them. So it's like a vicious cycle. If they take that mind, if everybody takes that mindset, not my problem, come back to me when it's $100 a ton or whatever the number is, or 125 even, you know, we'll never get the early investments that we need to do this. Because of some of the pressures from society, because of the way things are counted, I see a lot of emphasis on reductions. And I don't think enough companies are embracing where removals fit in that journey.
One of the things that does intersect with what we're focused on is really setting high quality standards. And I think that's something that's really important as we talk about creating a proven industry, creating one that is viable, that we have to think about what are high quality standards and making sure that we're doing carbon removal really well. Our job in the carbon removal space, if we want to get to what is good carbon removal, not just carbon removal at scale, not just 10 gigatons, but 10 good gigatons, highly accountable, equitable and just, focused on legacy emissions, that takes a lot of reflection for the carbon removal sector, where I think a lot of times I think we can think of ourselves as the underdogs or the little guys in the room because, you know, we have to fight for attention or the UNFCCC is saying something negative about our work. But in reality, I think that's not the power dynamic at all.
What do you think needs to happen in the next year? So just very short term, 1 year. To see even more momentum, to see more development in this industry?
Really strong standards and the beginning of big infrastructure investments.
We find that we need 4 to 10 gigatons by mid-century for net zero, and that we only get about half of it, looking at the IPCC scenarios, from the natural carbon solution. So there's about half of the problem that's not being solved by this solution.
To get to net zero, we're going to need carbon dioxide removal to operate at a gigaton scale. That's a billion tons a year or more. So why do we need to do it now? These technologies take a long time to develop and scale up. And if we don't start now, they're not going to be available to us at mid-century.
We're convinced that early demand and early capital need to come together to drive the growth of highly durable and additional carbon removal solutions. Microsoft is planning for a portfolio of roughly 5 million metric tons per year of carbon removal in 2030 across nature-based and engineered solutions. And we know that long-term contracts are needed to jumpstart the development of those projects. We estimate that most of the carbon removal capacity that will be online and available in 2030 will have been designed by 2025.
I'm here because JP Morgan announced a commitment to $200 million of CDR offtake, about 800,000 tons of carbon removal in the next 9 years. Part of that commitment was with Climeworks, which was mentioned, the largest CDR offtake from Climeworks. And so a huge thank you to the team at Climeworks for developing what they did. Something I've learned being in the corporate space for that long is that you have to bring people along on a journey with you. If you truly believe in what you're doing, and you believe that what you're doing can make change, you should bring people along on that journey. What I think is important about the voluntary carbon market, it is still a very disaggregated market. And it is young, and it is relatively immature in that way, and it needs to find its place, right? So what do markets do in general? So it can help deploy proven technologies at scale. It can help innovation and bringing new technologies to us. It brings integrity to those technologies through the scale and volume of trading in those markets. But the other thing that the VCM is it's us. It's everyone in this room and everyone on the phone. It's the scientists and the technologists, and it's the engineers, and it's the buyers, and it's the project developers. And so I'm happy at any point today or in the future to talk about how we did that, how we built the business case internally, how we built a portfolio of solutions that ultimately nets to $250 a ton so that we could get this through the conversation within our firm. But I have one last ask of you as my time is running out here. Beat us. Beat us. Do a bigger contract. Push the bar. We move the bar from here to here, move it to there. Somebody is out there who is in the audience today who will be here next year. You guys can do it. I'm looking forward to it. Challenge us, challenge yourself, and thank you for the time today. Good luck.
We need actual projects at that scale to show the world what those projects look like. The second is to make sure that those projects don't just work from a technical or a business model standpoint, but engage communities and provide robust environmental protection so that people want carbon removal in their community.
Back in the first picture, Africa is a climate victim. Africa is the youngest continent. 2.5 billion people, a quarter of the world's population, will live in Africa by 2050. Try inspiring those people with a story about how they're the victim of the world's other actions and they are passive in the face of the disaster that's affecting them. That's not a way to motivate anyone. That's a course for disaster. So how do you motivate them? How do you give them a purpose? How do you activate them?
We have to reduce our emissions as much as possible, as soon as possible. So as you leave, take the information that you have heard here, take the inspirational stories that you've heard, take the challenges that you've heard, and share them. Share them with people that you work with. Share them with people who are looking at investing in climate solutions. Share them with researchers who are lending a hand. Share them with business people, engineers. Share them with teachers. Share them with your kids. We need every single person's hand on that giant boulder, pushing it down the hill as fast as we can, because I'm convinced that together we truly can build a better future.